How's it going, everybody? Jordan here, and in today's video, I'm going to go over my new realistic hybrid build that packs a huge punch, can nearly one-shot mercenaries with the sword, and assassinate them all without elemental damage or abilities. And the best part is it has a nearly 90% melee resistance, making it nearly invincible. This build is so much fun to play. I can't wait to show it to you. But remember, if you enjoyed the video, please remember to leave a like. And if you have any questions, be sure to join our Discord community or leave your questions in the comments of this video. All right, let's get into it. The first part of this build is that it relies on the Blade of Yumminess. This sword can be bought from a blacksmith in any part of the game. I've made a video explaining how to get it, but it's available to everyone. The key perk is that it gives you 250% all damage, but cannot use abilities. That's an insane damage boost, but the ability to not use abilities coincides perfectly with a realism build. And the best part is, abilities does not include charged heavy attacks. You can use charged heavy attacks with this perk activated. One thing you also may want to know is that the perk can only be engraved or used on swords and daggers. I've been trying to put it on spears, staves, and heavy blunt weapons, but I've been unable to do so. So you'll either need to engrave it on a sword and then use a heavy blunt weapon. Otherwise, that's how it's going to work. The second part of this is the build does require some perks from the new Atlantis DLC. This third episode has released some amazing perks into the game and have made builds incredibly powerful and has introduced three awesome perks that allow for insane hybrid builds. The one that we use on this particular build is it converts 50% of all warrior damage bonuses to all damage. And what that does is allow for this build to one-shot assassinate mercenaries. On top of that, making your regular basic arrow bow hits with this build extremely hard and powerful as well. It doesn't one-shot mercenaries, but the damage is incredibly noticeable. And lastly, the transmog of this build is also made up of items from the DLC as well, so keep that in mind. I will give you a few suggestions on what to do. Otherwise, this build does require some of those items. All right, let's get right into it. So, like I mentioned, the primary weapon is the Blade of Yumminess. We have assassin damage, damage with swords, 250% all damage but can't use abilities, and then we engrave the 30% armor penetration perk from the Atlantean Blade. It's important to note that this armor penetration perk is almost more than 30% damage boost. I've tested it against the 30% damage while at full health when it comes to swords, and it deals almost 80,000 more damage per hit than the 30% damage at full health does. So it's a significantly better engraving for this build. My secondary weapon is the Sword of Kings, which you get from one of the Lost Tales of Greece quests. So both these swords come default with the game, but the perks used on them are from the DLC. So we have the warrior damage, all damage, and then melee charging speed, which is almost instant with the melee charging of the sword. And then we have the converts 50% warrior damage bonus to all damage. That is incredible. Now, if you don't want to use melee charging speed and you want more warrior damage, you can always swap it in for an epic sword like this one with crit damage and damage with swords on it if you don't want the melee charging speed, but I enjoy it. For the bow, we have warrior damage and hunter damage and crit chance. Now, the hunter damage is optional here because you don't use fire or poison or overpowered attacks. You could go with a warrior damage, headshot damage, and crit chance bow here. The thing that I'm looking for mainly is the warrior damage and the crit chance. Now we engrave the final melee attack damage applies to nearby enemies, which is also a perk from the new third episode of the Atlantis DLC. This creates a red ring around you when you hit an enemy, and every enemy that's aggro against you will receive equal amount of damage that you're delivering to the enemy that you're hitting. Now it's a little weird and quirky with conquest battles because there's a lot of enemies that aren't aggro on you, and you'll notice that the ones that are not aggravated against you will not take damage, but only the ones that do. So it might make sense to run around, group up a bunch of enemies, get them united against you, run up to one of them and just kill one of them, and you'll watch all of them drop dead. It's a great tool to use to kill leaders and their guards. It's a lot of fun to use, and it brings AoE damage to a single target weapon like the sword, and it makes it incredibly powerful, especially for a realism build that's not using elemental damage. For the head, we have warrior damage, crit chance at full health, and damage with swords. For the gauntlets, we have warrior damage, melee resistance, crit chance, and crit damage while at full health. This build does have a lot of melee resistance in it, making it incredibly tanky as well. The chest, we have warrior damage, crit damage, and elemental resistance, and then we engrave 15% all resistances from the Greek hero set. For the waist, we have warrior damage, crit chance, crit damage while at full health, and melee resistance. I'll point out that the waist and the gauntlets are identical with all of their perks. And again, you can get a variation of these. So if you have warrior, melee resistance, and crit chance, you can engrave crit damage at full health instead, whatever items that you happen to have. And then finally, on the boots, we have warrior damage, crit chance at full health, crit damage at full health, and then we engrave more warrior damage to go with that perk that converts our warrior damage to all damage. All right, since there isn't much abilities, we won't go over that. Let's go straight to the stats. Now, we're working with a lot of different things here. We're working with 250% all damage, which applies to warrior damage, assassin, and hunter damage. And then we're converting all of that warrior damage back to more assassin and hunter damage, making this an incredibly strong hybrid build. And as you can see here, we're approaching 509% warrior damage, almost 500% assassin and hunter damage, and then all of this with an 87% damage with swords. Then if we look at our critical modifiers, we did reduce a bit of crit damage for the melee charging speed, but again, you can get that boosted. It could be 100% if you put 20 points into crit chance. I didn't do that. You could take away the melee resistance from the waist if you want it to be less tanky and put the Nemean Lion engraving there to hit 100. There's a lot of options with this. You can easily hit 100% and a bit more crit damage if you want. I chose to go more tankier. But on top of that, we are dealing a nearly 100% crit chance with 576% crit damage. This is a nearly 1000% damage boost on all warrior, assassin, and hunters when you're critting. It's absolutely insane. And then lastly, we'll look at the defensive modifiers. We have a pretty large armor boost. Our melee resistance is approaching 90%, which means melee hits are breezes, and with health restored back masteries, you can keep your health refilled very easily without using any abilities. Our ranged and elemental resistances are also pretty strong as well. All right, we'll briefly look at the abilities. Obviously, you're not using any abilities, so it's best to just not put any points into them. Now, the ones that you can use is, like I mentioned, the charged heavy attack, and then also all of these passive abilities here, like Sixth Sense, Archery Master, Gear Master, Weapons Master, and Shadow Assassin. After that, you're going to want to spend all your ability points on masteries. Now, like I mentioned, if you just put 20 points into crit chance on the Hunter tree and 20 points into crit chance at full health on the Assassin tree, you'll hit 100%. Crit chance. I didn't do that here, but you can do that yourself as well. Now, the primary perks that I focused on are those, the crit chance and crit damage and damage at full health, crit damage on the hunter tree, damage with swords on the assassin tree, and then health restored on successful parry on warrior tree, and damage dealt restored as health on the warrior tree. The reason I focused on these two masteries is because you do not have the ability to gain health back because you can't use abilities, but you can get health back through these two masteries without using an ability. So it's very good to make sure that you put some extra points into both those, so every time you parry or deal damage, you'll get health back. After that, everything else is pretty much a bonus. I put points into damage per enemy engaged to work with the AoE attacks of the sword, armor penetration, some more tankiness if that's what you'd prefer. And then I went ahead and went even further and put points into warrior damage, hunter damage, and assassin damage, as you can see here, to boost the overall hybridness of this build. Okay, let's look at the transmog for this build. It's made up of a lot of different pieces from all over the Atlantis DLC. So for the primary head, we're using this first civilization hood. Now, this is technically from the first episode, but this variation comes from the third episode, and you can find it in a blacksmith there. It's got a nice cool hood and this little Isu face mask here, which I think looks really cool. Another alternate is this DeCastes hood, but I really like this look here. For the gauntlets, we're using the gauntlets of the Fallen from the Fallen set, which comes from Hades. It's got this nice dark and gold look, which is kind of matching our hood already, and it comes together really well. For the chest, we're using the DeCastes breastplate, which comes from the third episode, which has this warrior gold and black kind of look, which I think looks really good. And then for the waist, we're using the dark variation of the Isu commander's waistband. It kind of gives you a little bit of a definitely an assassin kind of capey feel, and it feels incredibly fun and strong to wear when you're using it. And then finally, to match the gauntlets on the feet, we're using the boots of the Fallen to kind of round out the entire look, which makes me think it looks incredibly fun and I really enjoy it. So that's the realistic hybrid build. The combination of 250% damage and no abilities, and mixed with the 50% warrior damage applies to all damage, allows for so much damage to be dealt as a warrior, as an assassin, and as a hunter, and brings back the roots of original Assassin Creed games, in my opinion. You're not using any of the crazy abilities that have been introduced with Assassin's Creed Odyssey, but you're still able to pack a huge punch with a sword, assassinate anyone with one hit, and then your bow strikes still deal a good chunk of damage, but they don't quite one-shot, but it's still useful in fights if you need to shoot someone real quick. I hope that you really enjoyed this build. Let me know if you have any questions again, and feel free to join our Discord. And if you enjoyed this video, please again remember to leave a like or subscribe and hit the bell as well. And I also stream on Twitch, so go ahead and head over to twitch.tv/itsjordandoes if you want to ask me some questions in person. I love hanging out with you guys, and I appreciate all of you. Thanks again so much for watching this video. I appreciate all of you, and I'll see you guys next time.